Professor Jean Dreze, thank you for having breakfast with UNICEF. For 20 years, you've been one of India's foremost development economists. During that time, what do you make of India's great economic story against the fact that there are 300 million people still in poverty today?
Well, I think firstly, it's very important to be clear as to what this figure means, 300 people being below the poverty line. It's a staggering figure. It's the official Indian government's figure based on household consumption surveys and the official poverty line, which is basically 32 rupees per person per day, which is, let us say, the price of a bottle of milk, 1 liter of milk. I mean, that's what you can get from the poverty line income. It's a standard that was set in real terms many years ago at a time when people considered themselves lucky to have 2 square meals a day, but it doesn't enable you to have anything like a dignified living in contemporary society. And just to convey that point in a different manner, I brought here a little basket of food items and other commodities that you would be able to buy with this 32 rupees a day. That would include, let us say, 0.5 kilo of rice, which is less than 1500 calories, a few potatoes and onions, which are the only vegetables that a lot of people are able to afford a lot of the time. A banana, which is actually a bit of a luxury, but anyway, let's put that in. 1 rupee for healthcare in the...
What, 1 rupee being a couple of American cents?
I can't even find healthcare now. Sorry. Oh gosh. Here it is. So 1 rupee in a country where the healthcare system is virtually completely privatized, 1 rupee for healthcare is what you can buy an aspirin with that or something. It really doesn't get you anywhere. Same point with education, not as privatized as healthcare by any means, but rapidly going in the same direction. 1 rupee per day, something like 0.5 pencil, a little bit of soap, a 5 rupee bus ticket that will get you 3 stops down the road, and after that you'll have to walk because you won't be able to afford to go further in the bus. And after that you'll be left with 5 rupees for everything else, for clothing, for entertainment, for social obligations, for rent, which can be very, very expensive, of course.
This is 300 million people.
That's right, that's the point I'm coming to. You know, 5 rupees, by the way, is, you know, you could just about repair a bicycle puncture with that. But anyways, you're right. The point is not, I'm not commenting on where the poverty line should be. I'm saying that even after you set the poverty line at such an abysmally low level, there are still 300 million people who are somehow living with less than that. I mean, that's really extraordinary, extraordinary level of deprivation. And that is one symptom of the fact that something has gone wrong. I think in the last 20 years, you mentioned the growth story. The growth story is real. I mean, the country is growing very fast, and that has been a big opportunity for this very poor country. But the opportunity has been very poorly used, and in particular, huge numbers of people have been really on the margin of that whole process. And there's data to corroborate that, for example, on the growth rates of real wages, which has been about 1% per year in the last 20 years, or the growth rate of incomes of the poor, which again has been around 1% per year, compared to 6, 7, 8% for the economy as a whole, and much more, of course, for the richer people. So I think the evidence is there, and we have to come to terms with it.
Zeroing in then, within poverty, on child malnutrition, why is child malnutrition so stubbornly high, remains so stubbornly high in India?
Well, firstly, when we say it's high, let's be clear, it's basically among the highest, if not the highest, in the world. I mean, there's no country in the world, not Niger, not Mali, not Nepal, not Somalia, that has a larger proportion of underweight children as India. Same, more or less the same picture if you look at stunting rates, if you look at deprivation of micronutrients like, you know, iron deficiency, vitamin A. In all these respects, India is pretty much at the rock bottom. Now, one reason for that, which is fairly obvious, is, you know, what I've just shown, that a nutritious diet is just beyond the reach of large numbers of people. I mean, if you were to replace this basket with what people actually need for a healthy living, you know, some eggs, bananas, diversity of vegetables and milk and so on, and provision for children and all that, it would just be way beyond the poverty line. So I think huge numbers of people just cannot afford a nutritious diet. That's one part of it. I think it's just one part of the fact that basically all the enabling factors are missing. You know, purchasing power is missing, women's empowerment, education, time is missing, public healthcare facilities are missing, child nutrition programs are missing, and that's the end of that whole process.
Are there nutrition lessons from more progressive states in India that can be taken, and are they transferable?
Well, I think there are many lessons from the more progressive states, starting, of course, with Kerala, which has been well recognized for a long time for its progressive social policies and the outcomes of these progressive social policies. And more recently, other states like, for example, Tamil Nadu, Himachal Pradesh, which have really shown that you don't have to wait to be rich to confront these mass deprivations, nutrition, food insecurity, poor health, illiteracy. I mean, you can actually really do something. I think one other lesson from these states is the importance of universal provision, universal access to healthcare, to education, to child nutrition programs, to employment under the Employment Guarantee Act. I mean, these states, by and large, have followed that universal route. And that is one reason why these interventions have been more effective in these states. Whereas in other places, and also from the central government, there's a great push towards targeting and restricting social benefits to certain categories of people, in particular to those who are below the so-called poverty line that we discussed earlier. And that approach has proved very divisive and very ineffective. And I think that democratic debate in the last 2 or 3 years has actually helped to bring out the limitations of the targeted approach and the case for universalism, and there's a much greater acceptance of that today.
Is there any magical set of interventions you can imagine that would, if you could implement it, would change the lives of tens of millions of Indian children today?
Well, I don't really believe in magical interventions, or for that matter in single interventions being successful everywhere. I do think that education has a fundamental importance for development and for children in particular. It's actually important for almost everything. It's important for economic growth, it's important for children, it's important for the demographic transition, for health, and for that matter for democracy. I mean, it's an important foundation of democracy. And especially, of course, girls' education. I think this is one thing that we have really learned in development economics in the last 20 years, is the importance of female education and the very strong impact of that on child health and nutrition has been demonstrated almost everywhere. I mean, any data set you want to look at, you'll find that it's that relationship comes through very clearly. So I would say if you talk of long-term interventions, that is absolutely fundamental. In the shorter term, I think that we really have to find ways of reaching out to the very young children below 2 years of age, because now the scientific evidence is very strong that this is really where their future is determined. And there's very little today in most Indian states to take care of these younger children. So I think an enormously greater investment has to be made there. I would particularly mention the whole issue of women's disempowerment and gender inequality, because again, in this respect, India is one of the most problematic countries in the world, with huge levels of gender inequality, which is reflected in, for example, low access to employment for women, virtually no property rights, low levels of education, and basically put themselves in a situation where it's very difficult for them to take adequate care of their children. And the care of children depends a lot of, obviously, in Indian society, on the abilities of women, which are constrained and limited by these multiple disempowerments.
From the perspective of the poorest children, what's the latest evidence say about school feeding programs?
Well, the word feeding is a bit of a misnomer, because I don't look at these programs as just feeding. I mean, we call it midday meal program, and it's basically a multi-purpose program. It's partly feeding, of course, and improving the nutrition of children, but it's also a lot of other things. It's helping to bring them to school. It's a socialization experience for children who come from different classes and castes and who learn to sit together and share a meal. It provides employment to very large numbers of rural women who are cooking the meals. So it's all these things together, and I think there's a fair amount of evidence now that all this is happening to a large extent. For example, the impact on school attendance is pretty well documented now. I mean, it really works. I mean, of course, there are other incentives also, like textbooks and free uniforms and so on. But the thing about the meal is that the child has to come every day, to get the meal, and so it's kind of self-driven. The children are themselves keen to come to school and enjoy that experience, not just the food, but the experience of eating with their friends and so on. So I think that there's a lot of positive evidence, but I think there's also evidence that a lot depends on the quality of the program and how you do it. For example, many states now are giving eggs to children 2 or 3 times a week, and you can see how that would make a difference to, you know, especially to poor children who don't have any animal protein most of the time and who need them to grow.
Jean Dreze, thank you very much.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.